you know, this is cliche, but you never just throw a punch. It's where you came from, where you're going, who are you punching. It's like there's a story to be told with every movement. And
what's up, guys? Today's guest is an actress and stuntwoman. Please welcome to the JAMCast, Kate Boyer. What's up? How are you?
What's up? I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. Like I was saying off camera, I feel like I haven't seen you since back in the Legion days.
Yeah, it's been a while. That was a fun job.
It's crazy to think of how many years have passed since that job happened.
I don't even know. It's been like 4 years.
It's crazy to think about, because COVID was like a full year ago.
Yeah.
So like it was years before that even. So
it was so fun in LA crazy. With all our friends just doing ridiculous things.
And I only remember that because I just got a bunch of residual checks for it like last
week. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Exactly.
Like really good ones.
Some
decent
ones.
Okay.
I'm like, all right, Legion,
yeah.
There we go.
Yeah, so, COVID making people go back and watch.
So how have you been? I feel like every time I talk to you, you're always bouncing around project to project, which is basically, in my opinion, the curse of any talented stuntwoman in our industry during this day and age. So what did you just finish? I heard you just got off a project.
That's so kind. That's how I feel about you. not the stuntwoman part. I just finished Babylon.
Okay.
That's a movie that Whitney Coleman was coordinating. She awesome. Did a fantastic job. I'm a awesome. Huge fan of her. that was with... Margot Robbie, Brad Pitt, Damien Chazelle was directing. Wow. And so it's a period piece about the 1920s when talkies, like the silent movie era went into talkies. So really cool story. I'm excited to see it, but it was so much fun. I worked with amazing people.
Super unique. Now, obviously I know you can't talk about it because the movie's not coming out right now, but were you on there as an actress or as a stunt performer?
I was on there as an stunt performer.
Oh, okay. Okay. That's awesome. And
where's the air? Can we put the air back on?
Exactly. How long
did you, joke.
How long did you get to work on that project for? Was it like a short stint?
Yeah, it was about a month. Oh. So yeah, on and off. So yeah.
Still here in town in LA?
Yeah, we wrapped that.
Dang.
Go over to 911 this week. And I hear it. So you're going over to work for Brian on Tuesday.
I am.
Not on 911, but on another project.
They're one of my favorite couples, like hands down in our industry.
Power couple.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. I talk to Brian all the time. I'm like, you're a lucky man, dude.
Oh my God.
I'm like 10 years earlier, I would have swooped her up. And
what a babe.
I would have had an amazing career.
She's majestic. Yeah.
I love right? Shauna. Exactly.
Just pass over that joke.
Exactly. I love Shauna to death.
Yeah, she's a badass. Yeah.
That's super, super cool. And so now, obviously, there's a ton of stuff that I want to talk to you about. One of the reasons I'm so stoked to have you here is I feel like one of the most requested things we get is to have more female representation on the show. You check both boxes because you not only are a stunt performer, but you are also an actor. And I feel like that's something that so many people in our audience are just fascinated with as far as how they can delve into that industry. So before we talk about what you're doing now, let's go a little further back. Yeah. How did you first get into the entertainment industry as a whole? Was it something you grew up dreaming about, or when did you make that decision?
I didn't know a damn thing about it. I'm from Philadelphia. Nobody, very blue collar. Nobody knew. Okay. I mean, I think I went to the same high school as Rocky or Sylvester Stallone.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
but yeah, I just started actually in community theater.
Okay.
Just asking a lot of questions. From there, someone said, you should start doing background work. Started doing background work. I was like, this is great, but not how I'm going to, you know, move up. And so I just started watching people on set and I went, well, who are those people? They were PAs at the time. I didn't know that.
Okay, okay.
So I remember I wrote down my number for who was then the key PA. And I was like, hey, if you ever need any extra hands, da da da. And he was like, yeah, okay. And I looked and I was like, hey, at least I tried. Like, I was just like, I gave him my Philly, And he looked up and he's like, all right. And then he called me and I started PAing. I had enough days for my DGA. Like,
wow.
I like did it for years. I worked locations, first team, started with walkie PA. I don't know. I think one of the longest runs I had was one of my first jobs. I was like a walkie PA on The Last Airbender shot in PA.
Yes,
and
did.
A background PA.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you worked on that?
No, I didn't.
Oh,
okay. A lot of my friends did. Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, 100%.
Well, so I learned, I have a funny story about that. You want to hear it?
Yeah.
Oh
yeah,
my God,
of course.
I can't believe I'm going to tell you this. Okay. So I actually just, this came up the other day, so I totally even forgot this happened. So on that film, I would bring the background actors to set.
Okay.
And one of the days, there was a guy, me and him just like, you know, just got along real well. And so when I brought him over to set, he walked over and he was like, almost like, thanks for bringing us. And he was like, right?
Yeah.
So I went right back to him and I was like all over the top. And I was like, and then right as I did that, M. Night like turned and looked at me and I was in his line of vision. And he was just like, he didn't know, was that for me? Totally. And I was like, oh my God, I'm fired.
How embarrassing.
Fired. So then like the next day when we wrapped, the black SUV pulls up and I'm about to leave. And when it pulls up, it just rolls down its window and M. Night goes, and then it pulls away. It just rips away. I'm like, what the fuck?
That's
like,
so crazy.
Yeah, it's just so dumb.
And this is all fully back like in your hometown in Philly when you're doing this PA work?
Yeah,
and stuff?
So I did, actually, good question. So I did it in PA.
Okay.
And then I would take the bus to New York and I would do, like I was day playing. I would like sleep in hostels. And then when I would show up, because I worked in locations a lot, there were like, basically locations shows up like hours before and hours
always
after.
Always first in, yeah.
Right.
Of course.
So I would wear like layers of layers of clothes because it was very cold. So I would stay at the hostel and like switch out my layers for the next day because I wanted to carry everything I owned with me.
Totally, totally.
So I would like show up to set, work 14 hours and switch the clothes that were on it. It was just a mess, but I did whatever I could. I slept at Penn Station for a couple years. Like I did whatever I could.
That's crazy.
That's where I discovered stunts. I was working on a show called Rescue Me. There was a stunt coordinator, wonderful man, Danny Aiello, who ended up passing, and he said, you'd be a good stunt girl, and I said, I know. And then so whatever money I got from PAing, which was shit money, I just invested into driving school, training, da-da-da, and then I got hooked up with a stunt team in PA called the Fearless Hyenas.
Okay.
And we would train at this gym, like a Muay Thai gym, and basically, I remember the one time we had this trainer come in and like basically we had a mattress that we found on the street that we were practicing backfalls on.
Totally. Yeah,
and like
yeah.
High falls, and like it was so sketch, but all those guys are now working in New York and very successful. And I feel like we were like the underdogs who just were like, okay, no one's going to train us in stunts. Like we're going to train ourselves. And we all fought to get our first jobs. And I stood on the corner for 8 hours to sit, to shake Tim Cella's hand. And I was fucking cold. And he was such a gentleman. And he brought me on a drive for 2 weeks on my first film, Water Mitty. So that's like the long-winded story of like how I got into stunts. It was a very long, long journey.
Yeah, that is super wild. And obviously, like, with that being said, did you grow up being an athletic person that felt like inclined to do stunts? Or what was it that made you feel like it was something you could do?
Well, I think I'm a lot different in that aspect where I feel like I have a lot of unique skill sets that my growing up was a little different than probably the norm. My parents didn't have much money, so I never got to stick with one sport for a long time. So I would like go into something and then they would do it until they could afford it. And then I would like, you know, whatever. So I grew up doing like anything a kid like would want to, I don't know, karate, gymnastics, soccer, basketball. I loved basketball. So like all those, like, you know, all that stuff. But, I don't know if I want to talk about that. My dad was a bank robber, so this is like a whole other thing.
Okay.
And so interestingly enough, there was like a lot of things that were unexplained because I didn't know this at the time growing up.
Okay.
So there's a lot of things in my life that weren't explained, and I just know why now a lot of things were the way they were. So that answers your question.
That makes sense. Yeah. That's a wild story to think about.
Yeah, yeah.
And so like obviously this is like a question that you're not supposed to ask women, but I'm just gonna throw it out there to ask. What age were you when you were, I guess, told by that coordinator that you would be a good fit for stunts?
I think it was 20.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay.
Yeah.
So like that's cool. And I only asked that just so that our audience had some perspective of like where you were as far as like life-wise, career-wise and stuff like that.
Yeah. I mean, like if you're looking for a window, like if people are listening going like, how long does this take or whatever? Yeah. I mean, like I always say with stunts, it's like you could be a gold medalist in one thing, but you got to be well-rounded in many 100%. Things. And I mean, I would say it takes years. It's not overnight. And I feel like a lot of people, it looks like, oh, I just got this job. It's an overnight thing, but it's really about constantly putting out good work and you'll eventually get found. Someone will give you a chance, you know, meeting people, networking, being a good person, being respectful.
Totally.
Like, you know, like any career, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, it's so unique though that you had that experience starting off as a PA, just simply because like myself, I got in this industry and I went straight into working on gigantic features and TV shows, which is a blessing. But at the same time, do you feel like you have a unique perspective and almost more of an appreciation for when you're on set as a stunt performer, as an actor, having known, like having started off as a production assistant, you know, like do you value it that much more having started, you know, for lack of a better term, at the bottom of the barrel, you know, for a lot of people in this industry?
Of course.
Okay.
We have the greatest job in the world. I know some days we don't feel like it, but really we truly, truly do. We get to tell stories physically and we get to play the actors. We're part of that performance.
Yeah.
And I couldn't think of a more beautiful thing. I mean, stunts is, you know, this is cliche, but you never just throw a punch. It's where you came from, where you're going, who are you punching? It's like there's a story to be told with every movement. And I never knew about that until I remember it was on set of Rescue Me. And I remember that same day they did a T-bone and a firefighter was falling out of the building on fire. And I just went, that's a fucking job. And that's telling the story. And at the time I was going to acting school and I was like, that's what I want to do.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that's super, super cool though. And you are right. We do have the best job in the world. It's just hard some days when you're sitting there in the trenches going on like hour 18 and you're covered in dirt.
Or wake up the next morning and you're exactly. like, I can't figure out what part of my body hurts more.
100%.
Yeah.
100%. And so one thing I do have to ask though, and it's just because I'm a fan of the show too. I saw that you did actually work on It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
Oh, yeah.
Did that happen? Was that shot back there in Philly or where did that shoot?
Yes, I only did the exteriors back in Philadelphia.
Okay, okay.
So I think I can't remember, honestly, but I'm pretty sure I worked on the Green Man episode when he was in that was like the one that everybody like 100%. Remembered.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I remember being at the stadium like shooting that. So I think I did, but I don't know.
Crazy.
You don't always end up watching episodes you work on.
Totally.
But I have seen other episodes of that and it was just so funny. Yeah.
So once you started your stunt career on Rescue Me, did it kind of
Start it on that. I started on a Water Mini, but I was PA'ing
Rescue
Me.
Okay. So did your stunt career take off right away or was it something that you had to continue to pursue actively?
Honestly, I got really lucky. I have worked steadily ever since I started. the only break that I've taken was this past year. Actually, 2 years I went and I studied at the American Academy of Dramatic Arts for acting. And then literally, I thought it would be slow this year, but the last year was online and I was still getting calls. Thank God, I'm so grateful. But I was like, on set, like trying to hide, making like pretending I was home in my Zoom session, like doing a theater show.
Totally.
Like, but yeah, it's been really good. And I attribute that to one, working really hard, and two, coming from a PA background. Like, I understand it's really helpful because you understand that you're not like one, the one, you're part of a team.
Totally. Yeah,
and that there's like a lot of unique skill sets that come with that I feel like I can bring when I'm hired.
Okay.
That's so conceited.
Such a good answer.
How did you get your first job? Tell me
how
that.
Did I get my first job in stunts? I fell into it.
You literally?
No, that's a joke. No, my first job in the industry, let's see. Technically speaking, I was in college and I got a call from a friend of the family that said there was a TV show looking for martial artists. They could do like traditional martial arts. And I was just partying my ass off in college, not going to class. I was going to class the midterm and the final.
I saw you went for theater and dance.
Yeah, that's what I got my degree in.
At where?
Santa Barbara, UC Santa Barbara.
Amazing.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
I don't know how I got a degree.
Don't say that. I do. I see everything you do. Are you kidding?
I'll be honest with you.
You're
I barely went to class. Yeah. But because of that, so literally it was like my senior year and I was like, they're like, can you come down for an audition? I was like, yeah, I'm not going to class. So I literally just took a week off of school senior year, drove to LA.
That's a big deal.
Yeah. And what was so surreal about the whole thing, and I've kind of told the story once before, is the first person that walked in the room was a kid that I had met 6 months earlier at UC Santa Barbara, who was a freshman and said he was going to quit school to be a stuntman. And I was like, good luck, dude. Fast forward to 6 months later, I go down to LA for my first job, and he's the first guy that walks in the door. Aww. Second guy that walked in the door was Solomon Brendy, who's one of my best friends.
Yeah. I love that. I love him. That's so funny. Yeah.
Absolutely insane. And so I ended up like taking the job and I just didn't go to class for like a couple of weeks. And I filmed a TV show here for Spike TV.
Wow. Yeah. What show was it?
It was called Deadliest Warrior.
I love it.
Yeah. Deadliest Warrior. And then I went up to college, finished school. And then when I graduated, I was like, I'm going to move back to LA and try to do what I just did. And the rest is history. Yeah.
Fantastic.
Super crazy. Yeah.
I think it's incredible. I see all that you do and I feel like, I know you're the type of person you create something in your mind and you execute it and it's really admirable all the things that you do. And I saw you on Legion. I saw how you were, So what exactly, can you tell them what exactly you were doing? Because you would say it much better than I was.
What, on Legion? Yeah. On Legion, I was a fight coordinator.
Yeah.
Technically speaking.
You were also shooting everything.
Yes, I was.
It was fantastic.
In hopes of getting the chance to like hopefully direct down the
road.
That's
what I'm talking about.
Yeah. I feel like that's the goal for all of us is like shoot previs, get a chance to second unit direct and then direct, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, 100%.
I admire that so much.
Well, I appreciate you.
It's cool. No, it's really cool.
I appreciate
how many
that.
People talk and you do, so it's cool.
And what's unique to me though is that like you said, like I've been very fortunate because I was born and raised in the city. Like I'm more captivated by people like you that have actually taken the chance on yourself to completely relocate your life and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So at what point did you make the decision to move to LA and pursue things, I guess, on a bigger level?
That was probably about 7 years ago. I was singing in a rockabilly band with Ultra Records. It's a really random, crazy side story. And we were traveling the world for like 3 years.
Okay.
We opened for like LMFAO and Avicii and Benny Benassi and stuff. Like really cool stuff. We did a festival in Australia called Ultrasonic Festival.
Yeah.
So yeah, it was incredible. But anyway, so I was doing that and
I You're just going to glance over that like that? You were singing on tour for 3 years?
Yeah. No, we're talking about stunts.
But
why I'm saying that is I was pursuing the stunts and I was going to acting school. I was doing these things and the band was one of the best experiences I've ever had. They were amazing.
Okay.
And I had this moment where I was like, okay, like this is all wonderful. What is it that I truly want to do? I want to tell stories. And so I remember I had my apartment in New York and I just decided to leave that night with my bags. Didn't know where I was going to stay, what I was going to do.
Wow.
And I came out here. My friend had a room, offered me a room, which like was just crazy to me. It was so nice to be like, here, stay here. And so I stayed here. And then eventually I lived out of a Honda Civic because I was looking for a place. And so I lived out of my car until Jay Lynch actually found out that I, was doing that. And he's like, come stay at my place. And so you get on your feet. And I'm just so grateful to him. He's such a wonderful man.
Yeah, totally.
And then, so that was kind of it where I was like, I'm coming out here and I'm going to, when you make the decision fully to do something is when like the world really opens up to you, when you tell the universe, this is it. And you see yourself there. So I was like doing other things that I loved to do, but I was like, let me just only do what I really want to do, which is storytelling, which singing also is storytelling, but I love the film aspect. I'm obsessed with it.
Okay. And so when you actually like made the decision to move out here to come to LA, was the intention to focus on acting more so than stunts, or were you just kind of coming on like a path where they were going to parallel each other?
Fantastic question. It honestly was both. And a lot of people like say, like, you can't do that.
Which is why I'm asking it.
Yeah.
Which is exactly
they call
why
you
I'm
a stactor.
Exactly. Yeah.
It was truly for both. And I'm doing both. Life is good. Life is good. I don't know what to say,
100%. No, I think that like kind of like what you said, like how you just use the term stacked or whatever. For those that don't know what we're talking about, for a long time, there was like a stigma that kind of went around where it's like, if you're going to be an actor, you have to be an actor. You don't want to do stunts on the side because they used to say that people won't take you seriously and they'll view you as a stunt person. In my personal opinion, though, especially in this day and age with how much, content is being created and how many roles we need to fill, I literally think it's like the dumbest thing in the world that if someone's athletic enough and inclined enough to do stunts that they don't just make some money on the side, like it seems almost like a waste of talent to not pursue both if you're in LA.
Yeah, I think that a very well-known stuntman now director had once said to me, you have to be a good actor to be a stuntman or a woman.
Agreed.
And I think that's, it's as simple as that. Yeah.
100%. There is also a reason why, in my personal opinion, not everyone in our business can do motion capture.
Oh yeah.
Right. Because not every stunt person can necessarily act or, take on a character and be able to portray them in that way. But like you said, in my personal opinion, really good stunt people inherently are actors because our job is to pretend that we get hurt or die.
Right.
Get up and do it again.
Right. A million times.
Exactly.
What video games, because we did talk about this, yeah. Have you done?
Video games have I done? So True Crime, Streets of Hong Kong was one.
Love it.
And then I was a character in Call of Duty for 3 different games.
Amazing.
And I think I've done 4 of the Call of Duty games.
You're so cool.
And I think you got to do one of them recently,
I
right?
I did.
Which one did you work on?
Call of Duty Black Ops.
And did you shoot at Activision?
Yes.
Yes. That's
so
my
much
studio.
Fun. Yeah.
Those
yeah.
are my boys down there.
The best people. Like yeah. truly, like they're amazing people.
Yeah. I've become friends with all those guys that are down there. Like Mike Jantz. He's like one of the guys that sits behind and does the data.
Okay. Yeah.
I've even had him drive for me as a stunt driver on jobs on the weekends. Yeah, because he's like, he's huge into like drifting and driving. And
oh,
I
love that.
And so literally I was like, hey man, like, I know you work Monday to Friday. I got a job on the weekend. And sure enough, he like came down for a Vans commercial, drifted a car for me. And
yeah,
then,
so you just coordinated a commercial.
I just coordinated a Samsung commercial.
That's huge. That's that's it. You made it, baby.
I'm trying my best.
You're not trying, you're doing.
I'm trying my best.
I'm going to be your cheerleader every time you say it. I'll be like, you are doing.
I'm trying my best. How long did you work on Call of Duty for? Was it for a couple of sessions?
I think it was the fall. There was days on and off
during
COVID, which was kind of crazy.
Yeah.
We were like,
did you guys do full performance capture with the cameras on your face?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it was a blast.
100%. Yeah, that's like my favorite thing to do.
Yeah, it was so fun.
Although I'm always self-conscious. I'm like, damn, like I can't do anything weird because they're recording my face. You know what I'm saying?
Very interesting for anyone listening.
Yeah.
When you have all the sensors on your face, like every little...
Everything.
Everything. There's nothing. You're in a blank room and you're acting like a helicopter's coming down and a bomb's going off and you have this huge gun. And you have to react to everything, but you have to also realize that, like, it's picking up everything.
Everything,
so
yeah.
just be there, live it, you know?
Yeah,
just,
yeah.
You know, there's not much you...
I used to always...
It's like you'd say acting. It's simple, but it's not.
I used to try to keep it exciting. I'd always try to, like, pretend to sneeze on my camera and just see who's paying attention.
Oh, no. Yeah.
I'd always be like... And then just wait to hear people yelling like, no.
I love it.
Oh, it's so good. So when it comes to your acting career, obviously we talked about your stunts and stuff like that. I believe your first breakthrough role, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, was a show for A&E Network
back in the days. Yeah.
And what capacity was that role? Was it like single day guest star or were you like, what was your role?
So I was a guest star. The pilot was based around my character who ended up being murdered at the end of the pilot.
Okay.
But it was with Chloe Savini. She's amazing. Joe Carnahan directed that.
Okay.
So basically I played a medical student who was kidnapped, tortured, and died. But it was an incredible experience. It was probably, if you were to say to an actor, what is the hardest job you would ever do? It was probably that because, you know, there was like, you're basically like put in a coffin, you're tortured, and they're like, and cry. I remember Joe had called me. He's like, hey, we loved your tape. We want to book you on this, but I need to know, can you cry? And I was like, yes. But so that was it. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Super crazy. I've had to cry one time on command and it is so difficult to do, especially like when you really have to do it. It's insane.
Yeah.
So over the course of your acting career, you've gotten the chance to work on a bunch of different shows, NCIS LA, Shameless. Is there one that stands out in your mind as your most favorite memory or one that you were the most stoked to work on?
I think the last one I just did on NCIS LA was my most favorite. They said that they might write me back, so cross fingers. I'm very excited about that because it was just a moment in my life where all the hard work over many years have accumulated and had let me enjoy the job. You know, I showed up and I had so much fun. It came out amazing.
Okay.
The crew is amazing. Have you ever been over?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
They're like another level.
I've worked on every season of that show, thank goodness, doing stunts. Yeah.
No way.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Thank God to Tugger. Yeah.
Yeah, seriously. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. He called me to double, I guess 2 weeks ago, but I was on Babylon, but I haven't doubled on there yet. I just acted.
Oh, okay.
So hopefully I'll, you know.
he's like, the best. Yeah. He pays so well.
Does he?
Yo.
Noted.
He's the kind of guy that will come up to me and be like, how's this? And I'm like, okay, thank you. Yeah, and I just walk away. I'm like, that's crazy.
What if he, like, have you ever, I'm not going to say what job. It was a huge, it was a Marvel job. No, I can't even tell this story anymore. Never mind. Nope, not going there.
we talked off camera about what can happen when you talk about these shit.
Yeah, never mind.
We got to be careful what we talk about on the JAMCast now, guys. I had a guest on here a couple of weeks ago, and we were just talking very candidly about an old project, and it got picked up by all of these blogs from Marvel fans. So now I warn my guests. I'm like, be very cautious about what you say. Everyone's listening.
Yeah,
so,
yeah. Love Marvel, though.
Exactly.
I do know.
We love it.
Yeah, speaking of that, have you seen, this is like totally tangent, but it's not, but Cherry?
No.
I just thought of the Russo brothers, and then I thought of Tom Holland, who did Cherry. Have you?
Please go
see it. Okay. It's so fucking good.
Is it good? Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I recently saw it, so. Tangent, but where were
we'll go check it out. No, that's awesome. I'll definitely check it out.
Yeah, NCIS LA. Yeah.
So along the lines of that, like when you're going out for these acting roles right now, because you are a stunt person, do you find yourself getting more opportunities going out for stunt acting roles, or do you try to compartmentalize and just go for straight acting roles?
I mean, I have a manager. I separate both. Like anyone who's like in this industry who's thinking of like, you know, acting and also, you know, working as a stunt performer, they're two different things. Yeah. You know, you don't tell the stunt people you're an actor, no one cares, and vice versa, you know? Every now and then there'll be an acting role that'll come along that will like you to have a certain skill and you could probably do it or do it and also be like, hey, let me get my stunt double out to do it. Actually the first acting role I ever had, Shauna Duggins came out to double.
No way.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Incredible. She was so nice. That's amazing. Her. Fucking love her. Anyway, can I curse on here?
Yeah.
I'm from Philly.
Good.
So
all good.
But, so very separate. What was the last part of your,
I just wanted to know if you go for stunt acting roles or if you try to compartmentalize and just go for straight acting roles, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. So, completely separate. Okay. Yeah. So, and there's not really an agent for stunts. So, you know, you get called for stunts and then you hear your manager, you know, for that. Sometimes they intersect though, and it gets frustrating. Like sometimes you'll commit to a stunt job or vice versa. And that's because they're two very different worlds. And my manager does a great job of being patient with me when I'm like, oh, I got a stunt job. And he's like, hey, but I have
an acting job. Yeah.
Snake Eyes.
Yeah.
We were talking about it.
Yes.
I had auditioned for the role of Scarlet.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I was doing Yellowstone stunts when I got the audition, and I was traveling back, and I had literally no time.
Yeah, to do
like,
it.
Like, I couldn't do it. And I was like, well, that was a pretty freaking big opportunity. And I was like, yeah, so sometimes that happens.
Yeah,
but tell me about when you you coordinated the reshoots or additional photography.
I coordinated reshoots on Snake Eyes, which is so funny that you say that because you literally are a perfect double for Samara Weaving.
It's crazy.
Yeah, and
it's
if crazy. Not, you
I'm
could
excited
just
to see
here.
Her in it because I loved watching her before. So because she did a Hollywood.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh my God.
100%.
Yeah. She's an amazing job.
She's so talented and it's crazy because so many people always mistake her for Margot Robbie. And I'm like, it's not necessarily a bad thing because you're both so talented.
And hot.
Yeah. It's insane when you look at them. I'm like, oh, I guess I can see how that happens.
They're both on Babylon, actually.
Yeah. And that's why when you told me you're working on Babylon, I was like, oh, she's doubling one of them for sure.
Yeah, right.
I was
exactly.
like, yeah, for sure. But
no, I'm just like a creepy. I'm sorry. We can't talk about it.
Exactly. Yeah.
But an interesting costume.
So funny. Yeah. So I know one of the other things you most recently did, and you kind of alluded to it previously in our talk, was you just recently graduated from acting school.
Yes.
So you can just let people know where exactly you graduated from and how long you were attending.
Yeah. I graduated from the American Academy of Dramatic Arts. Yes. It was a 2-year conservatory program.
Okay.
It was one of the best experiences of my life.
And what made you apply to that? Was that like a school you were aware of before you moved out to LA, or is it something you just became aware of while you were out here?
I always kind of knew about it. It was on my radar, and okay. I kind of had this, this is gonna sound a little cocky. I should, I was like, I'm only going to go if I get a full scholarship. Yes. And I got a full scholarship.
I was going to ask about that. I read. So yeah. How did you go about getting a scholarship? Did you apply for that? Or
no,
how
I just did two monologues.
Okay.
And, but that was like my thing where I was like, I can't afford to pay for the school. And I was like, I would love to go, but I can't afford it. So I was like, you know, I just prayed and hoped and manifested. And I was like, this, I'm going to get it. I'm going to get this opportunity. And I got it. And so, yeah.
And so how intensive is it for a school that's like 2 years? Is it like going back to school where you're there like 5 days a week having classes, or?
It's okay. Very intense. It's, they do it in a way, like in real life for an actor, you're constantly, you know, you get a script or you get sides that you, you know, you have to audition with like the next day. You always have to drop everything you're doing.
Always, right? Always, yeah.
Same kind of with stunts, right?
Always, yeah.
So they kind of put the pressure on you. So you're always like learning a new accent or learning 10 pages of dialogue, do the class at 10 a.m. the next morning. And it really just takes... It puts the pressure on you, but takes the pressure off and just lets your natural instincts come out.
Totally.
It was when you laugh and cry with the same people for 2 years, like you bond with them, and it's very sad to graduate and leave them. So I was really sad, but it was a wonderful learning experience.
Okay. Yeah. And how large of a graduating class were you a part of?
With COVID, it was smaller. I would say 100 people.
Okay.
Yeah, not very large.
And just to put it in perspective, because I feel like everyone always gets told like you should sign up for acting classes and stuff like that. What do you think is the major difference between that and like a school that people go to maybe like, you know, at nights twice a week or something like that? Is there a big difference as far as what you're learning material wise, or is it just the amount of times that you're getting repetitions?
Okay. Has to be understood what I'm going to say, because it's not going to sound right. I don't think anyone needs to go to acting school.
Okay.
I think that acting is instinct, and that if you trust that you, like, we all have lived through by our age, like, majority of things.
You've gone through the gamut of emotions.
Do you have kids? I don't have kids yet.
Exactly.
But yeah, right, exactly. Yeah. So I think acting is, they was like really simple, but also... Why I liked going to ADA was there's other tools that actors can learn.
Okay.
So dialects, physicality, dance, there's tools that you can put into your toolbox. So if you were to go back to your question to do a night class two nights a week or the academy, it's like anything, like stunts. It's the amount of time you put in. How are you going to be if you train one day a week or 10, you know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Now, does that mean you're going to have a better performance? No, but I enjoy storytelling. So I want to know, how do I learn an Irish accent? What are the things in my toolbox that I can pull out to make my character even better? And the academy gives you all of those tools and more, versus like a nightly class probably would give you a sense of community and a sense of, just getting those muscles working. So it's really two very different things, but at the end of the day, I don't think anyone really needs an acting class.
I feel you in that. Yeah. I feel you in that. Yeah.
Some
of my clients that have been the most successful, who I've like had the opportunity to train as a stunt coordinator, and they're like, you know, just getting their big break. The majority of them all just got their first big break without having ever taken acting classes. They just kind of got discovered by going out for one role, and CD see something in them, or, you know, producers see something in them. And then fast forward to years later, and, you know, they're like 10 projects deep now. And I'm like, oh, they just had something within them that people saw.
Yes.
And then over time, they're able to finesse and massage that and, you know, help her performances get better.
100%.
Okay. Yeah. And so I'm curious now, as a stunt person, I just want to know, does the academy talk about action, or do any physicality as far as stunts is concerned?
We have a stunt class.
Okay.
Mr. Leclerc. Do you know him?
I don't.
He was so wonderful. It was so much fun.
Okay.
It was fun being in the stunt class because I do stunts. Yeah. So everybody else was like, oh, okay, like, can we watch you do it? It was really, actually really like humbling and really sweet. It makes you realize, like, it's funny, like with stunts, right? Like, you have other people that like go to college for science or different things. It's like with stunts, you don't realize until you're in a class like that how much knowledge you actually have to share. You know, how to do a fight, how to do wires, how to do a high fall, like all these things that in, I would say, the real world, like, no one cares about
should necessarily have,
never talked about. So I was able to, like, people in class would ask me or call me and be like, what about this? What about this? And I was like, oh, like, this, I actually, you know, have a lot to share. So it felt really good. Yeah.
That's so funny. Yeah. It must be really, really funny to take a step back and be in like a stunt 101 class.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. 100%.
And which there are none. And you've had classes here for,
we've had some like occasional workshops, but that's amazing. I'm kind of like I'm kind of in the same school of thought as you, which is, I don't necessarily think anyone needs to go to a stunt school
or go
to a stunt class per se. Yeah. Myself and all of my friends have been highly successful just by, you know, training with people, like you said, finding a group and honing in on skills. But as I get older, I am starting to feel a little bit more like personally responsible with trying to help the next generation out. So
100%.
Yeah.
100%.
Even though there weren't opportunities for us, it doesn't necessarily make that right. So yeah, if I can, I'm going to try to give people a chance to learn a little bit of what we've learned over the years.
And that you don't have dirty mattresses here.
This is true.
They can actually fall on very nice mats.
I learned in the craziest ways, just like you back in the day. Really? Yeah, I remember in high school, like, I mean, I'm fine now, but like in high school, me and my friends one night went to our track. And we stole the mat from the top of the pole vault pit. Yeah, we literally stole it, took it to my karate studio. And my parents let me keep it there for like 4 years. Like stolen fucking mat. And all of my friends from high school would be like, dude, that's the mat from school. I'm like, shh, like, just keep it quiet. Yeah.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, so it's crazy.
What made you do that?
Because we just needed a mat to flip on. Yeah. This was like back in the days before, like, you know, 8-inchers were readily available and stuff like that, you know? So literally all I had was panel mats. And I was like, let's steal the mat from school, guys. We're going to have a mat to flip on. And so, yeah, Vlad Rimberg, who's a fight coordinator now, me and him, we used to use that mat all the time. That's
You grew up here.
I grew up here. I went to high school with Vlad. We've been shooting fight scenes together for 18 years.
Where in LA?
5 minutes from here.
No way.
Yeah, yeah.
That is so cool.
The house that I was born and raised in is like 10 minutes from here.
Wow. Yeah. Are your parents still here?
They are. They live in the house that I was raised in still.
I love that.
It's crazy. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah.
It's really crazy. So one thing I've always wanted to ask you, and this is going to be unique because it's something that you have experience in that I don't, and that's what I want to ask you about, which is we've done TV and films and we've done video games, but one thing that I've never done yet is I have never worked on a soap opera. And I know you've had the opportunity to double on multiple different soap operas.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to know, like, what is that like doing stunts on soaps? Is it like a very dumbed down version, for lack of a better term? Or like, what are you generally doing on soaps?
Soaps are a tight ship.
Okay.
They pump out really fast.
Quick schedules, I've heard.
Quick schedules, yeah. So everything, it's actually one of the easier jobs. And typically the stunts on soaps are... I mean, you're not doing like, you know, snake eyes, like crazy, you know, stuff, but it's a lot of like heart wrenching or someone's dying or falling and, you know, there's
like
a lot of
Pratt
falls.
Stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Okay.
So yeah. Mike Cassidy, Terry James.
Yes.
Yeah. They're amazing to work for and they always have taken good care of me and everybody's just really kind. It's kind of like you're going in, hanging out with a family for the day and doing some falls or some punches. You know what I mean?
100%.
Yeah.
That's super cool. Okay. Well, I got to check that off the bucket list one of these days.
100%.
100. And so like along the lines of everything that you've done, as far as your career is concerned, we talked about stunts and acting. What do you do, I guess, for maintenance, I guess. Do you, like, obviously you graduated
for
from
training?
The academy. Yeah, you've graduated from the academy now. So do you still work on your acting outside of auditions or do you wait for roles to come in and then you just work on those specifically?
Yeah, I mean, well, I do both. I'm starting a class at the Marklin Studio, which I haven't been. Have you heard?
No,
I'm
haven't.
Really excited.
I was going to say, I've never heard. Yeah. I usually know of all the studios. Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't, this just came, you know, I was became aware of the Markland Studio, and there's like a lot of great working actors who, you know, work out of there. So I'm starting there. So I have a play that I'm reading for that this week. And I just booked actually this morning, acting role in a new HBO show called Minx.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm really excited. So I shoot that at the end of the week. So I'm like, kind of like, I joined the class cause I was like, well, if I'm not acting, I'm going to be practicing. But now I'm like, oh shit, now I have the show and the class. So I'm kind of like fucked.
Totally. Good problems to have, right?
Yeah. Good problems to have.
The best problems to have.
It's so funny. I hear it out loud. I'm like, oh, okay. Yeah.
I constantly have to remind me. Yeah, exactly. You don't get it. Constantly reminding myself, like, what good problems to have?
Yeah. 2021 problems.
Exactly.
I do that. I do a lot of training. Flip Daddy, who's on the other side of this wall.
Coach Sean Marsh. Yeah.
Yeah. He's so amazing. Oh my God. His daughter's blowing up acting.
Yes.
Him gymnastics, trained boxing out of Fortune's gym. I just, anytime I have money, I have money now, but like, I mean, in the sense of, I'm like, oh, I got this residual check. Let me go to, you know, driving class. And, you know, I'm always like every day I'm doing like a different type of training for something. That's kind of like what stunt performers have to do.
Yeah.
You know,
100%. So what?
Yeah.
And I know one of the things you do for fun, I guess. Do you still ride in your spare time?
Oh yeah, all the time. Yeah. I have 3 bikes now.
3?
Yeah.
No way. Okay. What kind?
Yeah. I have a Ducati 1200, a Monster. I have a CBR 600.
Okay.
And I have a little Z125.
Wow.
That's like my favorite one.
Okay.
Yeah.
No way.
Do you ever ride Groms?
I have not. No. Okay. I've only ridden like a few times here and there. I'm not going to lie. I am nervous about getting a bike because I have a super addictive personality and every one of my friends that has ridden has laid their bike down at least once.
Yeah,
and I'm
like,
I have the worst luck. So yeah, I'm going to chill. Right. One of my best friends who lives in my guest house, he didn't fall down it, but he slid out the other day and his bike fell down Angeles Crest.
Oh no.
He got super lucky that he didn't die. But
seriously.
Yeah, I saw that. I'm like, yeah, I'm good. I'm totally good. Like, wow. I don't need to do it. Yeah.
Well, the Grom ride is actually really simple and easy, but they have like on Friday nights, they have this Grom ride and it's like 500 Groms, like fully pinned down the highway.
Sick.
Like,
so sick.
Yeah, it's so fun. So maybe you can come out and I'll put you on the Grom and then we can go. Dude, I'm going to hold you to it. We're going to do it.
I show up with my Razor scooter. Yeah, I'm just like,
that's dope.
25 tops. Yeah.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Oh, it's so
funny.
Anything
with wheels.
Exactly.
I'm all for it. Like, I've been like skydiving before and I'm like, but when I'm on something with wheels, I'm like, you know, what is that?
Do you ever get to combine the passions with work? Do you ever get to ride on jobs?
Oh yeah. I thought you were going to say, have I ever skydived on a bike?
No. Okay.
Honestly, mark my word. This is going to happen one day.
Skydive on a bike. It's possible. Yeah. But yeah, have you ever, been able to do jobs where you're riding, I guess, on camera?
I have.
Okay.
I have. Yes. It's like hanging out with friends, doing what you love.
Getting paid. 100%.
Yeah, those are the best jobs when you get to ride.
And so at this point, obviously, you're working nonstop in stunts, and it seems like you're still booking tons of acting jobs. What is on the horizon as far as like career goals in the end? Is the ultimate goal to progress through stunts to being a coordinator, or is it to be a lead actress in projects, or is it to progress to even being like a director?
Yeah, great question. It is to act on my own series.
Okay.
I actually just finished, it's been finished, oh my God, but with school I had to put it on the back burner. I have actually 2 different projects. One that I can kind of talk about is a 30-minute comedy script about being a stuntwoman. And I actually just finished my first short. I never directed before. I directed, acted, produced like the whole thing.
Okay.
It's like 15 minutes. It's about being a stuntwoman.
Okay.
Really funny. But I just think that the world of stunts is the funniest job in the world.
It really is. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. It's
like,
insane.
I get paid because you'd rather I get punched in the face than somebody else, you know?
I've also been asked to do the most ridiculous things ever where I'm like,
what's the most ridiculous thing that you ever had to do?
Oh, man. It's not the most ridiculous. I'll just bring up one that we were joking about on set the other day with 2 of my friends. I had to choreograph a fight scene once where a guy comes out he's like a robot, and he comes out of an operation and both of his hands have been replaced with dildos, and he has to do a fight scene where he fights another guy with double dildo hands.
That's amazing.
And yeah, that was a previs I'll never forget.
How did it go?
It was amazing. Yeah, totally.
You had a lot of practice.
The previs is absolutely hilarious, and it'll probably never see the light of day.
Oh man, I'm gonna
see
it.
Out of respect for my friends that are in it.
Yeah,
we did some insane stuff in that. So.
I wish I could talk about the
most recent one.
We'll
bring you back in to talk about that,
but to answer your question, which was so I want to be creating my own content.
Okay.
And you know, telling stories about women, powerful women, and people that are from places like where I'm from, where I don't feel like their stories are told much. There's a very interesting interview with Michaela Cole, who mm-hmm. did I May Destroy You.
Okay.
It's a new HBO series.
I haven't seen it. No, I haven't seen it.
She's a huge inspiration to me. It's okay. One of my favorite shows. But basically, she was like, I don't see, you know, I don't see myself represented in entertainment, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. I'm going to, like, write my own role and write, you know, my own story. And so this guy, Reggie, last name is escaping me, but he just interviewed her, and what I loved about your work is that I saw children from working class families and children of immigrants using the same slang in the street, you know, dancing, enjoying the same, like, the way he explained it, I was just like, yeah, like, I feel like when I watch a lot of movies and shows, I don't see where I'm from represented much. So mm-hmm. I have a huge passion to tell that story. Okay. So that's part of, like, what is part of what the short that I made involves too. So yeah, just creating, being with wonderful people like you.
I appreciate it.
You know, creating and telling stories.
And so as someone that's now stepped on the other side of the camera and had the chance to direct and do all that stuff,
yeah.
Do you have a preference for being in front or behind the camera?
I enjoy both.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And now this is a question.
Why put a limit?
This is true. Yeah, I'm someone that loves doing everything. Yeah, yeah. So yeah.
Do you like acting?
I do. And so yeah. I have an acting agent. I used to go out for roles here and there. I
saw your headshots there.
Well, thank you.
Dope.
I appreciate it.
What
I got over was just like, it's like you talked about before when you were up for Scarlet. I just ran into where I'm so constantly doing stunt jobs.
That's what keeps happening.
I never got the chance to prepare enough for these roles.
Yep.
And then when I do get them, my agents are like, hey, we have a great role. I'm like, I don't have the time to properly prepare for it. I'll try to even, you know, I'll get off set late nights. I've had my acting coach come to my house at like 11 p.m.
Oh,
and I'm like, I was just on set for like 15 hours right now. Like, even as much coaching she tries to help me with, I'm just drained, you know? So I kind of have taken a step back. I still do commercials.
Yeah.
Commercials is like my favorite thing in the world.
Oh, my favorite thing in the
exactly.
world.
Exactly. So, but yeah, I definitely don't pursue it as much as people like you do.
So. I think with acting, that's part of why I, you know, went to ADA, where I was like, okay, I've accomplished what I wanted to accomplish in stunts. I became a stunt woman. I've worked on, you know, projects that I've wanted to work on and loved and respected. And I am super happy in that department. What's the next step? Because we can't do this forever.
Exactly.
Our bodies can't handle it forever. And
I'm already done. Yeah. My body's already tapped out. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So I would like to act and, you know, produce my own projects and tell stories that are not commercial stories, but that actually mean something, where someone who, you know, grows up with maybe not that many opportunities can see other outlets and alternatives that they might not be aware of. And those are the stories and the people I want to look out for.
I think it's so important. It's something that, like, when I was younger, I almost took for granted the fact that there wasn't that much representation out there for myself. And it's almost something that you... like, I don't want to lean on it as a crutch in a lot of ways, but, like, growing up, you know, just from a personal perspective, there were no, like, leading Asian guys as actors, you know? There was no, with the exception of Yao Ming, there was no, like, Asian basketball players. So a lot of things growing up, I almost didn't even try, just because I simply didn't see representation. Whereas, like, looking back on it, all my best friends know that my favorite sport in the world, hands down, is basketball. And it's like, why didn't I try to pursue that? It's because I didn't really see someone on the big stage doing it. And now, as you know, sitting here at the age that I'm at, I'm like, damn, one of the biggest regrets of my life is not doing things like that as a kid, just simply because I didn't know what was possible, because I didn't feel represented, you know? So I think what you're trying to achieve is super important. It's so vital for kids to see someone from where they're from, you know, and just have something to have a goal after, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, why are we doing what we're doing? We're creating, we're telling stories, and every job, it's always going to be a better paying job, a more successful job, right? We always move up, but for what? At the end of the day, we go back to our families, we go back to our friends, and it's like, this is great, but we have to go back to where we came from and make sure that those people are represented and I don't want to say taken care of, because they've been they can take care of themselves, but in the sense of know your roots.
Totally.
You know, that's what it is.
100%. Yeah, for the longest time, I almost felt like a sense of guilt when it comes to our job, because we make insane money.
Yeah.
I definitely felt a sense of guilt during COVID times when I saw a lot of people displaced, not making money. And then all of a sudden, film was deemed essential. And I know we got a lot of backlash because people are like, how the fuck is the film industry able to operate? And, you know, meanwhile, I'm not able to do my job. But when I sat back and thought about it, I was like, man, entertainment as a whole is so vital and crucial for people's mental well-being, mental health. You know, I feel like what got half the people through COVID was watching things on television or watching stuff on Netflix and watching stuff on YouTube. And so as I get older, I'm starting to try to pick and choose projects that align with values that I associate with, or like you said, stuff that is going to be a representation for someone down the road to see. I'm no longer like chasing the bag. Like, I'm now chasing projects that resonate within my heart and scripts that I feel like could impact someone. So
that's exactly what I mean by representing. Yeah. And like during COVID, there was like a point, I think maybe if you were a normal human being, you went through a period of depression like I did.
Totally.
And you know, that happens, and it's our job to work through it and talk it out and talk to people. And I think that watching movies and even through Instagram, which that was a whole other thing, that you realize like you're not alone. Mm-hmm. And that is more what I mean by like representing where you come from and your roots, not that you're doing something for them.
Totally.
But that you're showing them that you're not alone, and that, you know, through storytelling, people learn and grow. And I just, again, we have the greatest job in the world. Yeah. I vibe with what you said.
100. And so this is a question I'm curious your answer is, because I have an answer that's clear as day. Do you get more nervous before a stunt job or before an acting job?
I get more nervous before this podcast. In the beginning, I was like, oh, fuck. I think you asked me something, and I was like, actress.
So funny.
Oh, shit. No, dude, it's both okay. Because there are jobs, like I did something on some show, like I guess like a month ago, and my heart was out of my chest, and I'm like, and it was like kind of a simple thing, but it's the simple things that can fuck you up.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So with acting, I mean, it depends on the role. Like, you know, with NCIS, I wasn't nervous at all because she's just a girl that's trying to have fun. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it really depends. What about you? Yeah.
I get way more nervous doing acting stuff than stunt stuff. Just simply because I've done stunt stuff my whole life, that I feel like physicality is something that I can lean upon as like a familiarity thing. But yeah, for some reason, I just get super self-conscious when it comes to dialogue.
I get it.
But what is super weird though is alternatively, like television hosting, I get zero nerves on.
And I read that you did hosting.
I started my hosting career doing a live TV show on MTV in front of a million people live on TV. I was like thrown into the lion's den. And since then I've been able to host for like Red Bull TV. I've hosted for a bunch of different things. And that's what's so weird is when I'm acting and doing dialogue, I get so nervous. When I'm hosting, saying lines, zero nerves at all.
See, when I have to not hide behind a character and I'm just me, I'm like,
I'm the opposite. Yeah, it's so crazy. Yeah.
Okay, so what's the secret to hosting? Like, what keeps you calm and like centered? And
that's a good question.
Doing a good job.
Honestly, I've always told people this. I have the most fun just being myself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can agree with that.
Because I feel like when I'm acting, I'm like making choices and I'm thinking like, oh, did I make a wrong choice? But when I'm hosting, I'm just kind of being myself, which is like, you know, the pros and the cons. You get me speaking, but you also get flaws when I stutter or make a mistake. And I'm like usually okay with that, I feel like. So
that's also, I mean, for me, because I'm an actor, like, I think those are the beautiful things to watch.
Right?
Like,
yeah.
Oh, yes.
Exactly.
He just twitched his eye. Oh, my God.
Look how amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. Oh, it's so funny. But yeah, no, so that's good to know. I personally, like I said, I get insanely nervous before acting stuff. So
yeah,
it's good to know. And so one of the last questions I have is, do you watch stuff for entertainment value or do you watch stuff from a studying perspective as far as R&D is concerned? Like, what do you watch?
Oh man, I May Destroy You. Please go watch this show. It is incredible. HBO. No, I love Schitt's Creek, but I know that's
yes.
long gone, but like,
oh,
holy
totally.
Shit.
I've watched every episode of Schitt's Creek, of
right?
course, yeah.
What We Do in the Shadows? Have you seen that?
I have.
So good.
That's so good, yeah.
I can't. Night Stalker, so good.
Night Stalker's good, yeah, 100%.
So clearly, I don't know. I just watched too. See, the life of an actor is usually... Like this play that I'm doing for this class this week, it's like heart-wrenching, and it's this like couple that is like they're like trying to love each other but they can't, and it's like, and I go through this all day learning these lines and doing this stuff, and then at night I just want to watch comedy. I don't want to, like, I have real life and then I have acting and then stunts. That's like, go do this.
We're literally the same, and that's why,
yeah,
I asked this question. I get some people that sit in here and they're like, literally, like, when they're not working, they're watching stuff to be like an encyclopedia of our industry and yeah. stunts. Whereas me, like, my favorite movies are like late night comedies or cooking shows or reality based competitions.
Great British Baking Show.
Yeah, 100%.
My Lottery, Dream Home.
I see that.
I'm obsessed
with Alone. I love Alone.
What?
Alone.
What is that?
Wow.
Is that a
Alone's
show?
On season 7 or 8
what
right
the hell
now.
What?
Alone is
it.
They drop 10 people off in the middle of a remote place with literally 10 items that
they
got
naked?
To choose. They're not naked.
Ugh, okay,
they have clothes.
Thanks.
But it's literally you're put out there with 10 items you bring that you choose and a radio, and the winner is whoever taps out last. And they're put into like the Arctic. They're put in the middle of nowhere. I think the longest someone's gone is almost 100 days.
Do you want to apply for the show?
It's no. I would last all of one day. I would last all of one day. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's why I'm so fascinated by it, is because I'm like, I could never do that, you know? So,
that's crazy.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. So it's good to know, though, that someone's like myself, where I just watch things just to be entertained, you know?
Just to be
turn my brain off. Yeah.
Yeah, just laugh.
Exactly. Yeah.
I don't want to like... watch like Night Stalker was another thing.
It was intense.
Everybody loves a good murder mystery.
Yes, 100%.
Yeah.
Well, that's super cool. And so this is a question I always ask people before we get out of here. So curious to see what your answer. You're like, what? So I'm curious to see what your answer is. Where do you see yourself 5 years from now? And then where do you see yourself 10 years from now?
Telling stories. I just want to be happy. I have goals. Obviously, we all have goals. And I'm going to keep that deck close because I feel like really good things are coming. And the stories that I want to tell, I'm like actually starting to write. And there's some writing involved. So who knows? I'm grateful for every day to be alive. And I'm going to be super grateful if I'm alive 10 years from now, you know? So...
is there a dream role that exists for you? Or is this something you're going to create?
Yeah, and I started writing it.
Okay.
So,
okay.
Yeah, there is. There is. Always the underdog. I love the underdog story.
Okay.
You know?
All right. Makes sense.
Yeah. What's the, you probably ask this question all the time.
Yes,
I have listened to other podcasts.
I do.
What is an answer that you often get?
The most common answer that I get, to be honest with you, it kind of depends. So I generally see two different schools of thought in that chair. I see one where people immediate and only answer refers strictly to their career. And then I have some people who completely eradicate their career and they go straight to, I want to have this many kids or I want to be married by this age.
Yeah.
And so it's really interesting because for me, it's so telling because I've asked 130 something people this question. It's really telling when I ask people that and what their first response is, because I'm kind of like, okay, I see where their brain's at. I see what their goals are. I see what like really is important to them. Whereas other people, it's like their brain doesn't even touch on certain aspects and stuff like that. So
Yeah, I
expected that answer to come from you.
So. Really?
Yeah, I really did. Yeah. So far, I've been able to guess most people where I'm kind of like, just based on like the, how our conversation goes, I can kind of tell like where their brain's at as far as like a goal perspective. So.
Yeah. I love that.
I've had some guests, two to be specific, that fully pulled out their phones and they have a list that they add to it on their phones on a constant basis.
Oh, hell
yeah.
And so
that was unique as well, to have someone that was so dialed in. I had a friend who came on and was like, here's my 1 year, here's my 5 year, here's my 10 year, and here's beyond. And I was like, holy shit, man. Like, yeah, so.
Yeah, see, I'm a little, I don't like to talk about things before I do them.
Same here.
So that's why I'm not saying it, because I'm like, I have that written down. I love journaling. I mean, you got to be specific because you got to put in that GPS so you don't know where you're heading. But I like to do it and then talk about it. So in 5 years, I'll be like, this is what I was thinking and it's exactly what it was.
And that's why I ask the question and don't answer it, because I'm the same way. Like I have so many goals that are, it would take me hours to talk about what.
Oh my God.
The 5-year goal plan is, but
one I will say, we'll see. Animal rescue.
Ah,
hell yeah.
What do you mean?
Like I just want an animal rescue. Like I want an actual piece of land in Topanga. Don't call me. I'm busy with my pets.
Yes.
So that's yeah.
And what kind of animals?
Any.
Oh, okay.
I want like, you got a pig, bring him over.
Okay.
Any.
Okay.
So yeah.
Well, I was not expecting that answer. So,
yeah, it exactly, just came out. Right? I was like, I'll talk about that.
Animal sanctuary. Right. There you go.
What's one like that you have?
Did I have like long-term goal?
Maybe not involves animals.
With animals?
Is there any that involve animals?
That is so funny. You know what? I do have some longer term ones, but I'll just put these out there so that it puts pressure on myself to get it done.
Okay.
And I'll just fuck it. I'll put it out there so everyone listening knows as well. We are in the process of working on opening JAMLanta right now. And secondary, I'm in the process of working with another good friend of mine on opening a production and photo studio.
Yes.
Yeah, which is so, I don't know why I'm doing it, but... Yeah, we had a meeting the other week, and we have a meeting when I get back from Ohio in 2 weeks. And so that is the next thing. And I'm also looking at opening a previous space here in LA. So I'm currently looking at 3 different buildings, losing my mind. But
close by or
putting it out there. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm looking at potentially one previous space still in Los Angeles in the Valley. So I never have to close JAM down for rentals. I can just rent that out. And then the photo studio will be separate from that. That'll probably be somewhere in Hollywood or Culver City or the West Side. And then JAMLanta is going to be in ATL.
So. That's amazing.
Yeah.
And much needed.
Yeah. Let's hope so. Yeah.
I'm inspired by you.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
I hope we're able to pull it off. And worst case scenario, at least we tried. So.
Yeah.
That's all that could happen, you know?
I mean, at least, that's all you can do.
All you can do is try, you know, so.
All right, I'll give you two of mine.
Okay, right. Let's go.
One is I want to open a juice bar in Philadelphia,
okay.
But it's actually like a truck. So I was looking at brick and mortar properties. I had a real estate agent sending me properties, but nothing actually quite stuck. But so I'll have a brick and mortar, but I actually want it to be food trucks, like a, juice bar around public high schools in Philadelphia, because I feel like a lot of the kids there don't have options. Like when we were done basketball practice, we went to the pizza shop.
Totally. I used to go to Del Taco after track. Yeah.
Dude.
It's horrible.
I wish I could eat now. Maybe not, but
so bad.
Right. And I think that food is a solution to so many things, mind, energy, lifestyle. I don't think that in like food deserts, like there's those options.
Totally,
even
totally.
Like where I'm from in Philly, there's not even, it's like you have to drive to like get organic. It's like, what the?
I mean, there's times here in LA where we live in a culture dominated by vegans and healthy people, where there's times where I'm like, I can't get healthy food right now. You know,
it's
like, it's like, yeah, just tough. So
yeah, it is tough. And so that's really a huge passion to me, because I feel like food really changed my life in a lot of ways when I became aware of what you put in your body, on your skin and your hair, what it does to you. So that is one. I would like to be a nonprofit for that. Okay. And then another is to sell the show that I've written, that I'm really excited about. I actually have two writing partners, but this one of my writing partners, we've completed this project, and it's really close to my heart. And it's about a character, a stunt woman that I really believe in.
Okay.
And I know that I feel really good about it. So I'd say in 5 years that's sold and it made or being made.
It may be, maybe on the air. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hell yes. Well, if it gets off the ground, or when it gets off the ground, let us know. Come on back here.
Yes.
And we'll definitely talk about it. Use this as a platform to get all the stunt people to watch it. And,
oh, I love that.
Yeah. 100%. So
love that so much.
Open door policy on here. I've had some friends come back 3 times already.
Really?
yeah.
This
totally
is fun. I can hang out.
I have a friend that's like, dude, I have a short film coming out. Can I come back? I'm like, yeah, let's do it. So
that's awesome. Yeah, so I have hopefully to show you the short film that I made.
Yes.
Yeah. We'll have to
100%.
Do that.
100%.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hell yeah. So obviously with everything you got going on, with that being said, can you let people know where they can continue to stay up to date with your own personal journey and follow you and where you got going on?
Yes, on my Instagram, it's Kate Boyer, KateBoyer.
Perfect. We'll put it on the screen. Yo, guys, with that being said, please be sure to hit that like button, comment, subscribe for brand new episodes each and every week. Join us every Monday for Jam Breakdowns and every Friday for a brand new JAMCast, interviewing influential members of the movement community like Miss Kate Boyer herself. So with that being said, guys, I gotta give one more very special shout out. Thanks for coming through. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
Of course. And as always, guys, coming through, I'm your host, Travis Wong. Thanks for joining us here on another JAMCast. Until next time, we'll see you all soon. Peace. We'll be right back.